Good morning, everybody. So my name is Adriano Piccinati. I work for Deloitte. I'm in charge of the art and finance practice. I will be your guide during this day. So we will start with in this morning with our break. With two panels. The first one is going to be led by Anders Pettersson from our tactics. So we are going to talk about the ongoing trends regarding art-related services. We will have a second panel, which is about fakes and forgeries and the protective measures when investing in art. This panel will be led by Markus Eisenbahn from Vanam, the auction house in Germany. We'll have a break, the lunch break, so the lunch is going to be outside of the room. So, and we will start again at 1:30, so be on time, so just to respect the schedule, please. And we will start it again with a new panel, which is going to be on the latest innovative development in the e-business related to art, and this panel will be led by Jeffrey Bolton from Art Insight. Afterwards, so we will have a keynote speech on art funds with one of our partners from Deloitte, Elisabeth Lyer. And afterwards, so we will talk about China. China has become the number one art market in the world, and we will look at its impact on the development of art as an asset class with Jan Robertson from Sotheby's Institute and Serge Tiroche. And we will have a break, so of 30 minutes, and we will reconvene at 4:20 to discuss about valuation. Valuation is a key aspect of what we discuss about when we talk about investment. And there, so we will have two speakers, Angela Morgan from Sotheby's and Sergei, for your last name is very difficult for me to pronounce, from Skate Art. And finally, so we will have a closing speech with Simon de Puri. So I hope that you will enjoy the day. So I'm very happy that you are all there. So it's the most important gathering that we have successfully organized so far with these events. So I'm very proud and very happy that you are all there. I also would like to thank, of course, our event team that organized the logistics aspect, but also would like to thank all the speakers and moderators, because this is a joint effort. This is a program that we have built together. So also something that you may have noticed is that this kind of conferences happen more and more all over the world. And just for your info, so first, so we will organize our next event in Maastricht in 2013 during TEFAF. The date is not yet confirmed, but I can already mention that it's going to happen there, so with the great support of ING. ING is the support of TEFAF, and they are also our main sponsor for it's one of our main sponsors for this conference. But also in terms of additional events, so in September, Skate organized an international art business forum where we partner with in Vienna during the Art Vienna Forum. Also, interestingly enough, just for your info, our Deloitte office in Beijing will organize its first art and finance conference of the 1st of November. It's going to be a full-day conference also on that topic, so you will be all invited. It's a bit longer, but if you would like to be there, so you will be invited anyway. And also our colleague from Spain, from Deloitte Spain, so they are in the room with Fundación Malaga, will organize also a full-day conference on this topic on the 13th of December, where you will be also invited. So you can see that, so we started 2008 with one event, so and bit by bit, so this event spread around and globally, so which is extremely interesting and very supportive for what we have done so far. Also, this is something that we could not have done without our sponsors, so I really would like to thank ING Private Banking, especially ING Luxembourg, for their great support. Also, National Swiss, it's one of the main insurance companies dedicated to fine art. We are in their hometown, and I would like to thank again Dietrich von Frankfurt for organizing yesterday the cocktail we had with the speakers of the art market, a symposium. So thank you very much, Dietrich, for that. Also, I would like to thank Fine Art Expert Institute. So they are based in Geneva. They have a very interesting booth in the room just next door, so where they can, we have a demo of what they do in terms of expertise related to artworks and paintings. And finally, I would like also to thank Crozier. So Crozier is a company in the logistic, in art logistic business. They are based in New York. And I'm very proud and very happy that they are supporting also this conference. Before I forgot, so you may have seen this document on your chair. So this is a survey. So please fill it, and please put it back in the box at the welcome desk. This will be very helpful for us and our tactic to produce the next Art and Finance report. You may have seen this report that we have issued in November 2011. This report has received an enormous acceptance and from all over the world. So we had downloads from New Zealand to Chile to everywhere. So it had a very, very strong interest. But we need also your contribution to make it even better. So please, this is very important for us. Take 5 minutes to fill it and put it back in the box at the welcome desk. So now let's start with the first panel. So I will welcome the first panel and the moderator and the speakers. So this panel is going to be moderated by Anders. So I know Anders now for 3 or 5 years, something like that, 3 to 4 years, sorry. We have developed a very, very strong relationship, and it's really, beside the great fun, it's super to work with Artactic. Anders is the managing director of Artactic that is based in London. It's a company that is specialized in everything related to art market research. They create very and super interesting reports. So Anders, I leave the floor to you and to your panel.
Well, thank you very much, Adriano, for that kind introduction. I want to thank Deloitte, its partners and its sponsors for this amazing conference. And we have a great program ahead of us. And I also want to thank the ambassador for a fantastic introduction. It was so good that I was starting to cross out line after line in my intro, which makes my intro much shorter, which is probably good for timing purposes. But anyway, I think the context, we're obviously in a position where Europe is sort of kind of moving closer and closer to some kind of edge. We feel that there's a kind of a sense that the deepening of the cracks within the European political and financial structure is a kind of widening. And investors around the world, I think, are sort of deeply worried about what might happen. And the whole thing about what you do in terms of investment, putting where do you put your money, I think is becoming very relevant. And the days where the government bonds, particularly European ones, was a safe haven, I think those days are, at least for now, probably past. At the same time, I think we're seeing this sort of development in the art market, where the art market is doing incredibly well. We have seen fantastic sales in New York last month, record sales or second highest in history. For those of you who have the chance to see the fair and talk to some of the dealers, there's actually a very good and very strong vibe and a lot of very strong sales over the last 2 or 3 days. So I think, you know, I say this again and again every time in conference, you know, maybe we're going to start talking properly about art as an asset class. What I think is interesting, though, and hopefully this is the panel today, is to start to talk about that art and investment is one thing, but art and wealth management is another. And I'm delighted to soon going to introduce it to Ruth, who's going to talk about this. But I think we're talking about not only art investment funds, we're also talking about the fact that lots of the clients of private banks today are sitting on substantial value associated with art. And the question is, what do you do with it? How do you deal with this particular asset? You're comfortable with real estate, you're comfortable with equity, bonds, etc. But if your client turned up on your door and said, I have a 50 million collection, I want to do some tax planning, I want to give it to my children, how do I do that? And I think banks are waking up to this fact that they got to do something. And it's interesting, earlier this week, a report from Barclays Wealth was published where they interviewed 2,000 high net worth individuals. And they found out that 50% of their clients were sitting on substantial holdings of art. And I think that's significant. And I think this is the community, those of you who works in this industry, I think are realizing something needs to be done. And hopefully this panel today will give some ideas of practitioners who's actually doing it. And if not copying what they're doing, there might be room for collaborations, etc. But I'm delighted to introduce you to the way we're going to work. We're going to have a brief a contextualization, a presentation by Ruth Bultmann, who will basically talk about art and wealth management and sort of kind of the new trends. And then we'll move into to the panel later on. So I'll introduce the panel when we start the panel discussion. But quickly, Ruth Biltman is a partner for the advisory and consulting for Deloitte Luxembourg. She's had sort of 10 years experience as a director and managing director for Luxembourg banking and fund management industry. And between 2006 and 2011, she was responsible for the setup on the daily management of business development of two management companies in Luxembourg. Her business experience covers project management, product development, investment fund structuring, central administration, fund administration, and custody services. She's also a chairwoman of the pension fund working group within the Luxembourg Investment Fund Association and a member of the American Chamber of Commerce Financials Committee. Ruth plays within Deloitte a sort of key role as a cross-functional role, I guess, between fostering the German initiatives across different service lines and industries. So with no further ado, I would like to invite Ruth to the podium, and then we'll continue the discussion afterwards. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Anders, for the very kind introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to present in front of you today. And there are really some exciting new trends in the art investment, and I'm very pleased to share those with you in the next 15 minutes. The first point of my agenda, of my presentation, is current trends in wealth management. There are some very general changes in private banking and wealth management environment after the financial crisis. We see that financial advisors and bankers need to be much more proactive than they have been before, because there is a lot of competition in the environment. And private banks need to offer new services such as tax and wealth structuring, reporting capabilities are very important, broader financial engineering solutions, and the expectations around the service level are also very much increasing. So there is a need for new clients, new client relationship, and also new solutions. And new solutions could be tangible assets being one of them. The second change in the environment is due to family office. The number of family offices in Europe is increasing, and family office is a clear new trend that we see. What are the differences between private banking and family offices? Well, I assume that you very much know what private banking is about. Family office, is treating wealthy families across generations. It is, compared to private banking, dealing with diverse assets, meaning also real estate, art investments, philanthropy, and covers the whole kind of different family needs. The focus is on total wealth management, and the product is really a neutral advice on different products and services. So family offices are interesting because they deliver a more multidisciplinary approach, combining different needs and also financial and non-financial solutions. As family offices cover different aspects, they are well-suited potential players in the art and finance environment. According to a study, Mitos Family Office 2011, family office very much invest already in art. So art is clearly the number one tangible assets for family offices. You see that in the first part. And if you ask yourself what is the main reason for family offices to invest in art, we see that the most important factor is passion and tradition. They are the main drivers for art investment. So art is a very good way to appeal to clients' emotions and also to its social status. And there is a sizable portion of clients' wealth already invested in art. If we did a little breakdown, the total number of ultra-high net individuals is about 11 million. And their financial wealth in 2011 amounts to $43 trillion US dollar. If we assume that 5% of the portfolio is assigned to art, they are 2.1 trillion US dollar. So there is a sizable market that we shouldn't forget about. Art and finance offers the opportunity of changing art assets into working assets. And there are different players servicing this growing and very unmanaged art and collectible assets market. Now we come to the second point of the presentation, art as obviously financial service opportunity. According to the Art and Finance Report 2011, done by Deloitte and our tactics, we found out that there are certain very important criteria. First, we have a rising demand for real tangible assets and passion investments. And the rising interest in art is due to the competition also in the wealth management industry. 83% of private banks felt there are strong arguments for including art and collectibles in traditional wealth management practice. The primary motivation for buying art is really emotions. So private banker thought there is a need, obviously, for their own education, but there's also a need for educating their clients. And art-related services at Currens focus on client entertainment and more relationship management, but there are new trends coming up. There's a rising interest in art philanthropy advisory. There is a development of art-secured lending. We will discuss about that later. And private bankers are more and more warming to the art investment market. This slide shows or outlines the different kind of art-related services that we see. These are mainly three categories. So the first is art advisory services, dealing with art research, art transactions, art management, structured solutions. And there are already many players present. So many banks, family office, independent art advisors. The second is art financing services. It deals with borrowing art against art, acquisition financing, and there are already fewer players, so some commercial banks, specialized asset lenders, and auction houses. And the third, and there we see a lot of opportunity, is art investment services. So art as alternative asset class, every kind of service around asset management, portfolio management, monitoring, and selection art funds. And so far, there are only very few players, mainly Chinese banks. So there are new opportunities for wealth management and investment fund activities. The number of banks involved in art and financing and art investment is still limited, so it's a place to grow. And given the high expertise required, obviously networking and partnerships is very necessary. Now we come to my home territory, because Luxembourg will become, as we already heard, a very important hub for art in 2014. And in 2014, there will be the Freeport will be opened in Luxembourg on the same lines as in Singapore and in Geneva. And the concept is mainly to store high-value objectives in a duty-free and tax-free environment. So this is very interesting. And there are different facilities that will be covered. So, for example, they offer showrooms, workshop for how to handle and package and restore art. There are on-site logistics services around shipping, insurance, how to handle goods, how to clear customs, and different kind of very special facilities for the different goods that needs to be stored. We see that there are different clusters around this new Freeport activity. For example, everything around security, logistics, finance, and art. So there will be new opportunities for players in Luxembourg, but also from out of Luxembourg, to use that new place. And we are very convinced that this is a very valuable addition and complements the existing financial services industry value chain. As a summary, so we saw that there is obviously a change in wealth management and private banking. There is more demand for tangible assets, and there's high financial wealth already existing in art. So art and finance has become a topic of interest. If we see that there are also more art-related services that are offered, there are more players that are interesting, and there are new facilities that are established, we see that there's an emerging trend in financialization of the art market. Art is now seen not only as an object of pleasure, but also as a new alternative asset class with interesting new business opportunities. And this concludes my keynote speech, and I would like to hand over to Anders.
Thank you very much, Ruth.
Okay, what I want to do, I just want to introduce the rest of the distinguished panel. And I'll, this is the problem when I didn't put the speakers in the order of my notes, but I'll start with Philip, who's the founder and the CEO of the Fine Art Fund, one of the now longer established funds out there. And I think I've been following you since you started. The Fine Art Group has now grown substantially and is now a team of 40 professionals and representatives in London, Lugano, New York, Athens, Dubai, and Miami. So it's becoming a multinational company now. It's as well as managing investment funds, it also provides art advisory services to banks in Switzerland, the States, UAE, Greece, Luxembourg, and other places. And Philip himself is a regular speaker. We've been on a couple of panels over the years. I have no idea what you're going to say today, actually. I guess before, background-wise, he come from a sort of an interesting. He claims, and I always say that, he claims he's not interested in art. I still don't believe you. I really don't. But he has spent 12 years at Christie's. With a prior experience in KPMG. He was at 33, he was the youngest member of Christie's International Management Board. So a very distinguished speaker indeed. We're looking forward to hear from Philip a little bit later. Next one is Annabel Burney. She is the Director of Corporate Sponsoring, Art Management and Events at ING. A role which she's had since 2011. And prior to this, she was the director, Art Management ING Group, which is basically looking at the procurement and the maintenance of the ING collection worldwide. Annabel started as a senior curator at the ING Art Management in 2000, and she also started the Art Advisory Service. It's going to be great to sort of look into the experience regards to that. She also has, it's just a certified valuer of modern and contemporary art. And she's been working many years prior to this in renowned art galleries and institutions in Europe, including Sotheby's, where she headed up the modern and contemporary art department in Amsterdam. And currently also sits on a number of boards of several museums and foundations. So thank you very much for being here. Then I'll moving on to Andrew Augenblick, who is the president and of the Emigrant Bank Fine Art Finance. I get always this Fine Art Finance. I find that sometimes difficult to pronounce. But he's a member of the Committee on Media and Performance Art at the New York Museum of Modern Art. He serves as a trustee at the Phipps House's Board of Directors, and he's a member of all the Partners Advisory Board and lectures at Sotheby's Institute of Art and Christie's Education. He was also recently named as one of the top 100 collectors in the United States by the Art and Antiques magazine. So it's interesting, he's going to not only come with hopefully his professional experience, but also some of the emotional side of actually collecting art. Prior to founding this company, he was president and co-owner of Related Companies, which was a privately held real estate investment company. And prior to that, he was working as a consultant for McKinsey and Company. So. And we look forward to hearing from you as well. And finally, if I can find Suzanne here. Suzanne Georgi, who is the head of the Art Advisor in Finance at Citi Private Bank. And this is one of the older, is it the oldest established art advisory service? It is? Really? Yeah, okay, good.
I can confirm.
Good, yeah. Okay, good. So I just want to make sure that when I say that's confirmed by yourself. Okay, so it was established in 1979, which means that there's been a long track record, and we're looking forward to kind of get your insight into how the industry has changed since 1979. The team itself features a team of specialists who consult with private collectors on building art collections, art management, estate planning, and also art finance, so the sort of lending aspect of the business. Before joining Citi, she was director of exhibitions and collections at the Morris Museum in Morristown, New Jersey. She also served as a director of the Payne Webber UBS, which now I guess became UBS Art Gallery in New York. She also worked as an independent registrar, managing several important private art collections, and she worked closely with art museums and exhibitions, including basically a registrar for the Department of Paintings and Sculpture at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. She's also a frequent commentator on CNN, Wall Street, the minor celebrity, Well, actually, celebrity probably. So I'm delighted to have all of you on board, and I think this is going to be hopefully an interesting discussion. We have 54 minutes and 46 seconds left. I can see that this is very impressive. That's the thing we have in front of me, almost a bit scary. Anyway, there's three areas I want to touch upon, and this is what Ruth already mentioned. One is the art advisory side. It's the art finance, so the art lending, and then I want to touch about the art investment. And the good thing is that all of you, in a sense, have something to do with all of it. Even if Philip sits there and is sort of talking about as a fund, he still does a lot of art advisories. I want to bring this in because there's an internalization of the expertise, and then there is some kind of where you actually banks are buying in Philip's expertise and which model should we go for, etc. So there's hopefully a lot of issues we can talk about, and hopefully I would like to. We're going to have some time for questions, I guess, sort of 10, 15 minutes at the end, so it allows you also to engage with the speakers. But I want to start with the oldest art advisory firm in the world, within the banking sector, I had to specify, and that's Sasan Joji. And I would like to maybe talk a little bit how you define, and I will go that question will be passed around, but how do you define art advisory within the context of Citibank right now? I mean, what is it that, what does that entail? I mean, in we know the big things, but what are you actually doing? And sorry, there's a microphone.
Well, we were established, as Andrew says, in 1979, and we essentially do the same thing we did as we were established. The thinking was that there's this large art market out there. There are many high net worth individuals are in fact collectors, and that people need help. People need help with their tax planning. People go to lawyers for certain things, and that people should go to an advisor for help when they're building collections. And we were set up, because we're in a bank, the bank had to peg us in a certain category. So we were set up in a fiduciary capacity. They deem us as giving investment advice, although we really are telling people to collect with their heart and their soul, and we're doing the background research to make sure that they are buying the best quality at the best price. And so we advise people around the world, a lot of new collectors, but also we've been, in the 30 years we've been doing this business, we are working with the same families for all that time, and now we're working with the next generations. So it's really personal curatorial advice.
Do you see, from when you started till now, I mean, there's a new generation of wealth coming into the market. I mean, is there, other banks have decided to either close down or limit their involvement in the art? I mean, Citibank has stuck to it. I mean, what do you think is the, what is the reason why this has kind of, I guess, survived a number of crises and it's still there? Is it seen as a core business within Citibank?
Yeah, it really is a core business. When you're giving, because our role is to say, hey, there's, like in 2006, 2007, when the market was getting so frothy for certain contemporary artists, while everyone was jumping in saying buy, 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 we're like, wait a minute, because we have a history, so we knew what happened in the 90s. Collecting contemporary art especially is a tricky business. There are artists that were very hot, people were clamoring for them in the late 80s, 90s, that you don't know their names anymore. They're just gone. People spent a lot of money, and now I'm sure warehouses are making some money having them stashed away in the back. So because we have the history, it's really about protecting, and so within the bank, we're making our clients very happy. So the bank looks favorably upon us. So we've weathered many, many ups and downs in the art market.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll pose the question to Annabelle. Again, you obviously have an experience both from the setting up the art advisory service within ING. I mean, how are you seeing this kind of service involved within the banks? I mean, what is the core focus of this service? What is actually being offered? I mean, we mentioned lending, but if I come to you as a client and say,
yeah, you should do that.
I wish, yes.
Well, we think of art management services as a very demand-driven department. So we listen to our clients and see what they are doing with their investments in general. And we saw the increase of the demand on art advisory services, and we established the department around that demand, listening to our clients and really taking notice of the fact that a substantial amount or a substantial percentage of their total wealth is invested in art. So why shouldn't we, next to our financial services and our real estate advice and our commercial banking activities, why shouldn't we, within private banking and wealth management, offer a service for a specific niche in the market where clients obviously have a great interest in? And if you want to team up with your client and be a partner, then you should provide these services. And that's what we do. We still do it, and we keep continuing doing it in the future.
And has the services changed over the years? I mean, is the market, I guess what we're trying to get at, is the market getting more, when you said demand-driven, are they demanding different things? I mean, is the market changing? Are the services you offer have to change as a result of a more professional market or new buyers coming into it? I mean,
yeah, I would agree with Ruth that we're dealing with family offices more and more, which is quite an interesting development, because we are guiding clients from family offices from one generation to the next generation. And where we started consulting clients to buy or sell art or not to buy art, which is a better advice even sometimes, we now help them developing their own museums or do big donations to museums, have wings named after their families, and so on and so forth. And in the beginning, it was just taking in all the art to the private collectors, and now it's more spreading around the art, making it visible and accessible to the public, and really dealing with the problem. I have this huge $1 million art collection, or €1 million often in my case, art collection. What do I do with it? Do I keep it for myself? Do we have to build a museum? If there is already a museum, which one do we donate these artworks to? And what substantial funds should accompany that donation for the maintenance of these art collections? And that is a movement from like more private collection indoors through family offices, more for the accessibility and the visibility of the collections nowadays.
Philip, you started with your the investment fund, but you have more and more. Well, I guess you, to some extent, has always offered the kind of art advisory services all from the beginning. But now this is kind of a substantial part of your offering. Now, from what's been, I mean, this is, I guess, is also demand-led because you realize your clients want these services. But versus the kind of ING private or Citibank private banking approach, where it's just kind of internalized and you are kind of offering the same services to the bank. I mean, what's the advantages of that model versus the other? I mean, or are they totally complementary?
Well, before I start, I was just thinking how amazing it is when I first started talking about investing in art in 2000. And I had, I think we had a conference at Maastricht, and I think there was an audience of about six. And I'm now looking at an audience of 200. And I think the six in the audience at TAFAF were Agnew's, Colnaghi's, Christie's, Sotheby's, and that was about it. And now they're all professionals in institutions and financial houses. So it's quite interesting to see what's changed here in the audience. But going back to, I mean, two things. One, when I was at Christie's, I joined Christie's in 1989, and I remember discussing the idea of art as an investment in 1994 with the main board of Christie's. And the chairman said over my dead body, will we ever discuss investing in art? It's vulgar. We don't do it. Our clients don't do it. And Christie's has no intention of ever going down this route. And I was at dinner with all the Christie's team two nights ago in the Dreikoeniger Hotel, and they were all talking about how wonderful art as an investment was. So it's amazing how fast forward and going back, having a history of being on both sides of the fence. To answer your question, what we tried to build up is a very, very big team of expertise. And having run Christie's in Europe and been there for 12 years, I remember that there's 700 people involved in that European operations. And I remember going to Zurich one day to meet a client, in fact, I think of ING, and they said, we want to invest in art and tell me all about it. And I said, we have an expert impressionist, an expert in old masters, an expert in contemporary. And he said, no, I know all about those areas. So I said, where are your expertise? And he said, I have expertise in all those areas. So I suddenly thought, you know what, I could fire all 45 members of my team and just hire this chap because he knows all about these areas. And what I've learned is you need a great deal of expertise in each sector to understand, to get to grips. And when you're putting a lot of money in into art, and we buy and sell a lot of art, and we put our own money into it, you have to really have top experts in there working with you. And I think that's what we can afford to do, and that's what we do. We're just concentrated, for many of the banks. Art is a tiny, tiny proportion of their assets under management. It's, they might transact, I don't know, 10 million, 100 million, 500 million, billion dollars. But as a proportion of the trillions of dollars that JP Morgan, Citibank, ING, or whatever manage, it is a very low on their list of priorities. They've got to sort out their hedge fund units, their lending units on real estate and all the rest of it. So art is way down the list. So then the question is, do the banks want to have it in-house? And you need a big team and it's expensive and you've got to be a big bank to pay that. Or do you have it out-house and bring in a team? And I guess that's a decision. Some banks want complete control. They want certain standards set from internally, and others want a team. And I guess we have about 45 people involved in our business now, which is a big team. And I realize you can't, when I was at Christie's and when I compared it to this one guy saying, I know all about art, it's one versus 700. We're somewhere in between with a big group of experts.
Thank you, Philip. I'll move on to Andy, because coming from two points, I guess, one as a professional providing art advisory and lending type of services, but also as a collector. I mean, let's put your collector hat on first. If you were, in terms of art advisory, and I guess that's what we're talking within the banking context, I mean, what if you were a private client of let's say, Emigrant Bank, what are the things you think that people want to have these days? I mean, we accept the fact that the art market is growing, we have this value there, but what are the demands?
I became involved in the industry in part because I'm a cautionary tale, and I think I committed every mistake that's possible. I began to acquire the collection really with no thought about asset allocation or wealth transfer strategies. For example, I bought the art in my own name. Well, an art advisor typically won't even raise the issue. We had tens or perhaps hundreds of millions of dollars sold next door at the fair. But an art advisor, a typical art advisor, won't necessarily think whether that should be acquired by the individual or whether in a trust or a family limited liability company or a partnership, whether it should be acquired by an onshore entity, an offshore entity. And again, that's really where I think financial institutions and that integration of art asset expertise and banking and wealth transfer and tax strategy expertise, that integration of the two is hugely important. I didn't have that expertise, nor was did I have a resource for that expertise when I started. I really didn't understand tax policy when it came to art, and so, and again, it varies from country to country, but in the United States, the federal long-term capital gains rate is 28%. I live in New York, so I pay roughly an additional 12%. So the genesis of a lot of what I did and realizing the mistakes that I made and ultimately starting this company was because I sold something that it appreciated significantly in value and found that the governmental authorities were my partner to the tune of 40% of the gain. And I realized that no one had ever said to me, certainly not an art advisor, well, maybe the most prudent approach isn't in fact to sell. So you probably did buy it incorrectly, even if you paid the right price, but perhaps there were other alternatives, and whether it's satisfying philanthropic priorities or transferring it to heirs or moving it into a trust for beneficiaries of trust or borrowing against it, there are a multitude of options that, again, a typical art advisor, not within the context of financial institution, really may not focus on. But I think it's really critical to understanding art as an asset and capturing that other part, not only as a thing of beauty, but as a source of wealth and a way to pass wealth across generations. So I think of that both as a collector, again, because I literally made every mistake possible, and I've built that into some of the business principles that we have. I think our business model is sort of in between, I think, Philip, with what you do, because we don't invest. We have two businesses. One is art advisory and appraisal. The other is lending. So we are part of a bank. We're federally regulated. But we are typically an outsourcing platform because we don't manage wealth for ultra-high net worth individuals. So we'll be brought in to work with bankers, wealth managers, trust and estate experts. And so to try to bring that expertise into organizations that already have tremendous expertise in other areas. Again, raising the issues about how should your clients be buying art. Again, perhaps hundreds of millions of dollars were sold at the fair. Well, how are those purchases funded? In the vast majority of cases, people aren't thinking about rebalancing their investment portfolios. They have to make an immediate decision. The dealer wants to be paid because he or she doesn't want to go through the fair only to find that the collector changes his or her mind. And so funding is done immediately with a wire transfer or a check, and immediately the person is thinking, well, which financial assets do I sell? Well, if the banker had been involved in that process and said, okay, let's think about a cash flow analysis. What are your likely capital expenditures this year? How much are you thinking of investing in art? Well, maybe the answer is to set up a line of credit. Again, it's the, I just bought something for $1 million US, how do I pay for it? Really not thinking in advance about how best to fund that and the tax implications.
Thank you, Andy. I'll come back to the lending aspect a bit later, but I want to, Suzanne, we're in the market now where you've gone for the internalization of the skills, basically setting up an advisory department or within Citibank's private group. Now, if we think about the art market now being a global market where we have China growing the way it's been doing, etc., and I guess as Citibank being a global bank, you are starting to face requests and demands from other parts of the world, not only necessarily New York and London or Europe. How do you deal with this thing? I mean, I guess one thing is what Philip said, you know, you can't, I mean, this market is so big that to be expert in so many fields is difficult. Now, how do you deal with this whole thing about, well, new markets, but also the fact that, you know, do you build a team internally? How do you rely on issues like valuation, particularly for lending purposes? I mean, how do you practically deal with this?
Well, you're exhausting me asking the question. I will say, first of all, that anyone that speaks Mandarin that wants to relocate to Hong Kong, send me the resume.
That's a recruitment.
We have a team of five specialists, so we specialize in different areas. And we have contemporary, we have impressionist, modern, 19th century, American and Latin American. And we are hiring in Asia. So if it's an area outside of our expertise, we tell people that, and we have a whole network of people that we can recommend. But we find with the team that we've got, we're in motion and can advise quite successfully. And we've had clients in Asia for 25 years. So that's really a growing business for us. And you know, we're approaching Asia more in a connoisseur's sort of way. We're really talking to clients about the art market, a lot of education, not so much getting in and jumping in and transacting. There's enough transacting going on there already. We really want to be advisors and develop the notion that you do need advice in this market. It's not just trading, that if you want to build a serious collection, you need to step back. You need to look at the artist within their whole context and really and get more of an understanding of art history. So we, being part of a private bank, we have the luxury of doing a lot of education with our clients, which is what we're doing right now. And also we do art management, so setting people up with fine art insurance, getting the collections inventoried, and you're really setting a groundwork for collecting in Asia.
Okay. I'm going to come back to some of the issues. We're going to talk about art lending and valuation later on and how we deal with those issues. But I want to just go to Annabelle regarding us. You actually, you set up the sort of advisory function within ING. I mean, for those of you banks who might be in the audience thinking about doing it, I mean, if you went back to that time, would you have recommended to do the same, or would you have gone for Philip's approach? But would you buy his services?
Well, now and then we go for Philip's approach, and then we refer people to Philip because it's a different type of business. Okay. And I think talking about art with your bank and your financial advisor in a trusted environment is still a really good asset for ING. Mm-hmm. And we can cope internally with a bit over 90% of the questions with our own expertise in-house. And sometimes we have to consult external advisors, but the question that is posed is often the location of the collection within the total of the financial situation of the client, within the total of the entities, with a fiscal aspect to it, and those questions, to discuss them with a trusted source, really are a unique selling point that I would take into the company at the same way that I did to have it result in what we are now.
Yeah. I mean, if we sort of not going to close the chapter of art advisory, because I think it's kind of embracing all the other services we're going to talk about a little bit later, but what would you say? I mean, I think this is also for Ruth, I mean, in terms of from kind of a, you know, what are the main challenges facing this industry going forward? I mean, let's say next 5 years, I mean, if we can just sort of with regards to the art advisory section. I mean, and Ruth, maybe start with me from a more strategic point of view. I mean, when you talk to family offices, what are the hurdles? Sorry.
Thank you. Family offices are, as I said, very much interested in a lot of different kind of solutions covering financial and non-financial aspects. So they are looking for people that can serve their different family needs, including needs around art services in general. So we see that there's an increasing demand. We also see that, as I said, the private banking and wealth management industry is more open for new solutions, so they include much more, and we have good representatives here, so the trend is clearly to include art advisory in the wealth management practice, as they include also other things like wealth structuring or inheritance planning, which is not their initial business as such. And we also see that, of course, it's a question of location. So we believe that it is very interesting to be in a place where the most services can be offered, the most of the services can be offered easily, which is interesting for us with the Freeport environment that will be created.
I can see this clock ticking, so I'll. I think we move into lending, and I want to first. There's a sort of most of here are the traditional lenders, and I guess there's this sort of notion of maybe Andy, you can clarify that there's two types of lending practice. I mean, a lot of people might be familiar with it, but for sort of clarification, there's sort of more the traditional loans that traditional banks are offering versus the more asset-based lending, and how they differ and what the clientele. I mean, I think it's interesting to know why would you use one or the other. One is obviously much cheaper, the other one is more expensive, but it might be relevant for certain type of clients.
I actually think it's there's a continuum of lenders, and I guess I'd argue there are three types. Christie's and Sotheby's generally do very short-term lending. They're doing consignment advances, so the loans may be 3 or 4 months in duration. Sometimes they'll lend for a longer period of time, but that's really in furtherance of their core business, which is to intermediate the sale of art. There are, in fact, asset-based lenders, and again, the risk tolerance for asset-based lenders really there is, in fact, a continuum. But there, the lender is looking primarily to the asset for credit support and really not to the owner of the asset. I think we as financial institutions fall into really the third category. And again, there is also a continuum where we're looking both to the creditworthiness of the owner of the collateral and to the collateral itself. So in Philip's case, you're thinking about alpha. What is the ultimate return? We tend to think about beta or price volatility. So we're approaching valuation in a very, very different way. Another example for a bank, we would be thinking about a correlation analysis between the source of income and source of net worth for the borrower and the credit characteristics of the collateral. So, for example, old master paintings and gold are non-correlated if you study them. And so the risk of underwriting a loan in that context, it's really much lower. It's a much safer loan. That's in contrast to a loan to a borrower where that collecting group, the demographics of that group, tend to collect very specific artists. And so the lender is really doubling down on the risk, because if there is a crisis in that industry, there's a flood of art that is quite similar to the market at that time. So again, it's really a continuum, and that's reflected in pricing. So you can have pricing varying from LIBOR plus 170 to 20 plus percent.
Suzanne, I mean, just in terms of both the questions for both of you, really, how this industry has evolved in the last, say, 5 to 10 years. I mean, what has happened? Is this a fad? Is this a fashionable thing that basically is just on the back of a high value in the art market and it will kind of evaporate? Or is this an acceptance among banks to start to say, well, we look at this as an asset now and we're happy, comfortable with the risk that we understand it? What's the thinking now within your institutions?
Well, from my point of view, when you go back 10 years ago, we had very little competition. Now we have a lot of competition. So that's one thing. There are many more banks that are getting into lending. And it's funny, I think there's part of it's the human condition. We have a new client who's a major collector, never had a credit facility before. And I met with him and he said, you know, I keep going to dinner parties and everyone I'm talking to, they're all collectors and they all have art loans, so I thought I'd get one too. So it made sense in his business and everything, but it's, there are a lot of people that are doing lending. I think there's a risk to it. I think that some of it's growing too quickly. I think especially in the contemporary sector, new banks getting into this market that don't understand market cycles are putting themselves at risk without knowing it, and are just looking at revenue growth, which we all know from 2007, 2008 is a dangerous way to go. But it's definitely here to stay. When I started at Citi, our loan sizes were, a $5 million loan would have been a big loan. Today, our loans are multiple hundreds of millions of dollars. So it's definitely changed.
Andy, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
I'm thoroughly convinced that people will increasingly think of art as an asset class, and they will constantly be looking for multiple ways to monetize that asset. Lending will always be one alternative. You know, selling, gifting, there are lots of other ways to monetize. I think, Philip, you hit it on the head. There are, in fact, hundreds of art markets. So anyone who professes to have in-depth knowledge of all markets probably isn't an expert in any of the markets. Certainly the nuances of old master paintings are radically different from truly the emerging art. There are risks that are unique to this asset class, some of which you're going to be covering in this conference. Fakes and forgeries, illegal import and export, the absence of a title registry, condition issues, marketability, how long will it take to sell works of art, what are the different sales channels for selling, things that are really we don't really find in other types of asset classes. So people who serve the ultra net high net worth community, a small number of them are committed to this asset class, and they're prepared to use their balance sheet and to make substantial investments, the city being the pioneer in this industry, really making substantial investments to add value to clients. Many either don't have the balance sheet because they are wealth managers, but not banks per se, or because these loans cannot be sold, there is no secondary market for an art loan. They prefer not to originate the loans, but to outsource them. Very much the same way they may not want to develop the infrastructure to develop proprietary investment funds, so they might reach out to Philip's company.
What's interesting is very few art collections are built up on loans. Very few collectors that I and investors I deal with have any financing on their art. They're financing on their real estate, they're financing their companies, but when it comes to art. Now, that was a very good thing in 2008 because, we've never borrowed any cent from any bank in any of my operations since I started, just because I had a memory when I was at Christie's of the issue of if you have to repay the loan in a crisis. So in 2008, if we had borrowed money, I am quite sure that in 2009, if there was a clause for the bank, they would have pulled the loan back from me, and certainly in our type of business. And that type of thing, if there'd been huge lending in the art market in 2008-09, the art market would have tumbled enormously. But it didn't, because there's very little lending in the market, very selective, very careful. These people on my right look at their all their wealth and not just the art itself. But what's going to be interesting is how carefully this business expands, and hopefully it will be carefully expanded. And I think it is being, at the moment, mainly quite responsibly done. But if it got like real estate got in and the banks then became uncomfortable at, because of other crises elsewhere, it would knock the art market for six. But at the moment, I don't see that happening for the next 5 or 10 years.
Yeah.
I agree with you in certain aspects, but not in others. Because fundamental to that is the issue of mismatch between the asset, the length, the investment horizon, and the corresponding term of the loan. And where people have gotten into trouble is they've mismatched it. They've acquired the art and expect to hold it for a long period of time, but they've financed it with 364-day paper, really a one-year loan. One of the trends in the market is to have much longer-term financing. So in fact, some loans, ours included, don't have mark-to-market provisions. There is, in fact, no acceleration, even if there's a material adverse event in the art market, for precisely those reasons. So we have loans of 10 years. And it is specifically because the collector or gallerist doesn't want to be concerned about being economically compelled or forced to, in fact, deaccession a work during a market turmoil. I think responsible debt capital has proven to be a way to, in fact, expand the market. There's a reason why car companies started finance divisions, and it's because they realized that more people could buy cars, more people could buy more expensive cars, and they could buy more cars, two cars instead of one car. Appliances, credit cards. If you look at the past 100 years, the development of debt markets for certain asset classes has played an enormous impact on that market, but only if it's done really responsibly. And right now, in the market, most lenders are only prepared to lend up to 50% of the value. Now, that's less true for some of the asset-based lenders that, again, are prepared to accept much higher levels of risk for much higher levels of return. But I think if you looked at the overall market, the largest capital pool is being provided by lenders that are willing to lend really only 50% of the value, and they are looking at the price volatility of the collateral itself. So if you can, in fact, get longer-term financing where the loan is sized responsibly and you're lending to people who have a prudent and legitimate reason for borrowing and a specified source of repayment, I think it really can, in fact, help develop the market. And in fact, I think the equity side is exactly the same. Art will become much more accessible to people. It is effectively a fund of funds. People who couldn't have a diversified investment in this asset class, you make it possible for people, in fact, to do that.
Do you think, well, Susanne, you mentioned the growth of the industry, that obviously you were one of the few banks offering this service, and now suddenly competition is increasing. I mean, is there a hurdle here where the industry is growing too fast and the capacity, not in terms of the number of works and money, but in terms of expertise? I mean, are we running into a potentially problem where people are jumping onto this bandwagon, hiring anyone with a label of an art advisor in an industry which is totally unregulated, where you don't need to have any kind of education to have, you know, are we in the early phases of a situation where we're going to have a kind of a cowboy?
I mean, what I'm seeing primarily in the United States and Europe is there's a new breed of collectors that are following the model of kind of the senior hedge fund manager type of collector. And we go to their homes and they're all collecting exactly the same thing. It's unbelievable. And so they've got Christopher Wool, they've got George Condo, they've got Cindy Sherman, Glenn Ligon, and it's all Richard Prince, exactly. It's all. Well, less of that.
They've got to have a Damien Hirst.
That's more in the West Coast. But people are collecting the same thing, and they're jumping into leveraging it. And you know what I was saying before about the 1980s, when there was, you know, Kia, Kuki, and Clemente, who's collecting them now? Everyone wanted them then. And history does repeat itself. And I think that it's a cautionary tale that is, you know, is going to come true eventually. So what I really worry about is, to your point, lenders that don't have the in-house expertise are reading the papers. It's exciting, it's fun, there are parties, you get into the social scene, but you have no context of the ups and downs of the art market. The way we do it at Citi is we have databases of every piece of collateral we have. We run reports of, you know, concentration issues by sector, by artist, where it is in the world, you know, who the lenders are. We are very cautious, which is why we've been in the business 30 plus years.
Annabelle, I mean, in terms of kind of being aware of those issues. I mean, when what would you be your recommendations to someone who's thinking about this practice? I mean, who says, you know, the potential lack of skills, what from an ING point of view, what are you doing to kind of with regards to the art lending side?
Well, we don't do art lending
at all.
At all.
Okay.
Because we've learned. And we've noticed that unregistered artworks in a non-regulated world is a bigger risk than we can afford ourselves.
Okay, so you
so we look would burned. We would not recommend an art loan. And in fact, I agree with Philip saying that it's only for a couple of people an interesting thing to do. And I'm very happy that there is a professional lending market within the company sitting here on stage. But it's not for us.
Okay, Philip. I'm just before we just jump on to art investment, we have a little bit of time. But why don't you lend a little bit, use your capital, a little bit of short-term lending? There are people out there who are using the money in that way. I mean, it doesn't need to be on the kind of LIBOR plus 175. You can, if you can get like, you know, 20, then that might be quite a nice return on capital. So, have you thought about, because I mean, let's say there was a default, you could just put it into your fund at 50% of the value.
I've been approached to lend money, and people walk in with vast portfolios of art and say, "Will you lend on this one and this one?" I look horrified. I say, "Well, what's it valued at?" I got professor from some university who's valued this one as a $50 million Rembrandt, you know, would you give me $5 million on it? I said, I don't even think it's worth $2 million, let alone $200,000. But so we skirt round the issue. I don't want to become a pawnbroker. I know the type of clients we meet, who we have to deal with, who want loans at 20% above LIBOR, are pretty well on their last legs. And it's not an enjoyable experience. I'm not going to go and chase after their debts and family and all the rest of it. You've seen enough in the newspapers about that type of lending, loan sharks and so on. So I think it's not our business. We're not going to do it while I run the business. The lending LIBOR plus one or LIBOR plus three is not a very lucrative business for somebody like us as a fund manager. For some of the team here, it's enormously valuable to build a client relationship, to you know, work with the richest man in the world and lend him $20 million or $50 million, but have other assets worth billions is really interesting. What I do is I just buy the art for what they want to borrow, whatever it is, and I'll give them an option to buy back at a margin that I feel comfortable with. So I've done that with Degas and other works that I bought, and just let them say, in a year's time, you can buy it back at this price. And it's clear what the margin is. So it's if they can't pay the loan or can't pay the back at the end of the year, I own it. So it's fairly straightforward. But it's a very we don't do it very often, and I don't really like that's not our business model. Yes, you can make 20 or 30% or more on it, but we try to stick to what we understand. And lending is a very niche business. You take a different approach. You look at their wealth, their income. I have. You know, the due diligence you have to go into to find out whether they really are earning X and Y is not our specialty. We have specialty in art, in tax issues, in warehousing, in storage, in insurance, in all VAT and all that side of it, but not on getting private investigators to check out the real assets of these individuals and whether they're really money launderers or not.
Okay. I just one before we leave the art lending. You mentioned pawnbroking, and there's a number of players who they probably don't want to be called pawnbrokers because it has a certain sort of negative thing to it. But what I mean, I guess these things serve also a function for certain people because it. I just had a someone who was a barrister, and his income is erratic. He gets it in cash flow, doesn't sort of, it's not every month. Now, he had a stamp collection, which he basically through one of the pawnbroker asset lenders. He got his money, and because he needed it, and then the week after he paid it back again. Now, there is a room for this, I guess. I mean, there's a reason why they're there. So, are they? What role do you think they will play in this market?
A larger and larger role, and if you look at the demographics of the people who borrow from those types of lenders, It is largely people who are unbanked or underbanked, and so they use this for very short-term liquidity. And again, even if you're paying 20 or 30%, if you're borrowing it for 2 weeks because you have a short temporary need, it's just not that expensive, notwithstanding the interest rate. I think we all think about unfortunate cases where there are abuses by lenders, and there are borrowers who are financially irresponsible. But for example, a dealer who believes that he or she can purchase something for $1 million and sell it in short order at $1.5 million may be willing, in fact, to pay 20% interest because the loan isn't going to be outstanding for very long. It's a completely different business model from what we do, but I do think there is a legitimate need.
Excellent. Okay, we'll move into art investments, and Philip, you, as you are the representative of this, I'll start with you, and I'll move on to the banks later on. But are we on a? We were in the same place a month ago in at London Business School, and you mentioned in your presentation about the capacity of the industry that, you know, if someone gave you $1 billion, then you wouldn't really know exactly what to do with it. That there's maybe you changed your mind now after having been here at Basel, but at least a month ago you didn't know how to do it.
My kids worked out how to spend it.
So. Okay. But in terms of the industry, I mean, what is your predictions about the next, let's say, 10 years? I mean, how do you've seen it the last 10 years, and you've been part of the last 10 years. You've seen how it's evolved. What's going to happen?
I mean, when I started this in 2000, 2001, everybody said, it's mad. You're the only, you know, you won't be here in 2 years' time. When I came back in 3 years or 4 years, they said, we're amazed you're still around. We're now 12 years on, or whatever it is. I remember raising the first 5 or 10 million back in 2003. Ironically, I remember going to Madrid, and one of my contacts said, "You must go to this meeting." And I'd been to about 500 places, from CalPERS to Ontario Teachers Pension Fund. I'd been gone around half the world, and I suddenly thought, "Well, what's going to happen in Spain?" I was so sort of frustrated, and I walked into the room, and the family office said, after 5 minutes, they said, thank you very much, can we just wrap up? So I thought, normally they give me 25 minutes. So after 5 minutes, I said, well, thank you very much. They said, we've already decided what we're going to do, thank you. And I said, well, I suddenly thought, well, I may as well ask what they've decided. So I said, what have you decided? And they said, we've decided to give you some money. So I then thought the next question has to be, you know, how much? And they said, would you accept $10 million? And I looked at them and looked at my colleague and didn't know quite what to say because I hadn't raised a cent at this point. I said, well, I think I possibly could take that. Yes. And then I went to the next meeting straight after that into a bank just up the road, and they said we've decided what we're going to do. And I said, what are you going to do? They said, would you take 10 million underwriting from us? And I suddenly thought, you know, the places I least expected to raise any money at all. And I spent weeks, months in New York with nearby all this lot, and got absolutely nowhere. Now, ironically, I've just come back from, I've been in the last 10 weeks to Sao Paulo, Buenos Aires, Santiago, Jeddah, Bahrain, Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Athens, Barcelona, and here. And in all those countries, they want to put money into art. Most of them wouldn't have talked about this type of subject 10 years ago. So I think we'll see a mushrooming of money going into art that we have not seen in the last 10 years. I think that most family offices are amazed that the art market has stayed relatively stable in most areas. And they obviously read the headlines with the Munch making 120 million. And suddenly everybody thinks, gosh, maybe I can buy the next Munch for 10,000 and make 120 million. And I remember sitting with the lady who owned the Warhol $200 bill, which he bought for $386,000 in 1986, which was a huge amount for a Warhol in 1986. You could buy a house, $386,000 in 1986 would buy you a quite nice house in Chelsea in London, which today would be worth about £5 million, and that Warhol sold for $43 million. So there is an interest, an appetite, but they are very wary of the sharks in this business. And I had one client who said, Philip, I am perfectly capable of spending $1 million on a work of art, but to date, I've only spent $5,000 or $10,000 because that's what I can afford to expense, like I would on a holiday. And he said, for me to get to terms with $1 million purchase, it's scary. What do I believe? How do I go about getting the due diligence that Suzanne and Andy have been talking about? I try and make it easier for them by saying, we'll invest with you. You want to buy this for $1 million? We believe it's worth $1 million. We'll put in $250,000 or $500,000 with you, buy it jointly and invest in it as long as we can look at selling it in the next 5 or 10 years. But I think the industry will grow enormously. Wealth management will be offering this all over the world. There are some irresponsible funds that have come into this market. In China, I was asked, would you like to compete in this market? And I said, what is it you expect? And I said, we're looking at a 8 to 12% target return. And they said, we want 1,000%. And I looked at them and I said, sorry, did I miss the decimal point somewhere? And I just said, I can't deliver anything like that. How do you do that? And he said, we can engineer that sort of situation. And I said, look, it's an industry I don't understand, an industry I can't contribute to, therefore that side of it we're not going to be in. We're investing in old masters, impressionist, modern, contemporary, very contemporary, Middle Eastern, Latin American. And what was interesting, I remember one of my investors who did finally come from New York, big hedge fund manager, and I bought a Chinese vase in 2008 for $580,000. This investor invested $1 million in my China fund. And I got Christian Sotheby's to value it, and they valued it, I think, every year for about $500,000. Always less than it always happens, they always value it less than we buy it for. And he said, how's the fund performing? And every year I go back and say, if based on Christian Sotheby's valuation, you're down 10%. So he says, this is a pretty hopeless investment. And then we sold it. I won't tell you the story about it, but eventually we sold it at Sotheby's for $2.25 million 3 years later. And I walked in to his office that next morning. I'd been up half the night listening to the sale results in Hong Kong. And I walked into his office. He said, how did the vase go? And I said, you wouldn't believe this, Bill. It made $2.25 million. And he looked at me and he said, that's horrific. And I said, sorry. I said, are you not pleased? You've made four times your money on this. He said, no. Would you not like to reinvest some more money? He said, there's no way I'm going to reinvest. This is too volatile for me. He said, this is unpredictable. Last time you came to me, you told me that Christie's and Sotheby's have valued it at 10% less than you bought it for. And today they're selling it for four times the last recorded number. He said, I'm looking for 8% reliable returns, not this type of return. So you're not going to get any more money from me. So you can't win.
Excellent. Well, that's on that note, where I have one minute and 8 seconds left. But I wanted to pass that on to you. Within an institutional setting, I mean, you mentioned the increasing interest, but do you think within the next 5 years we will see an investment fund product as part of the Citibank's private bank offering? Can you tell? Can you?
Yeah.
You wait
4 to 5 seconds.
yeah, exactly. We're timed out.
My long pause. There's certainly conversations, and we're talking to people. It's a whole other conversation. But the fact that you can't that there really aren't indexes to really peg the market makes our people that, you know, in the labs nervous about it. But there are definitely conversations. I think there are ways to go about it. But
do you think in the next 5-10 years we will there will be an expansion of this market where actually banks will offer this as a product to certain types of clients?
Yes.
Good. Okay. That's and it timed out. Whew, excellent. Well, do we have time for three questions? We have time for three questions. So that was a late night. Late last night. I'll start with Serge at the front here.
We do have some microphones here, so if you could raise your hand.
Where's that voice coming from? Sorry, yeah. There.
Sorry.
Thank you. Just a question to the lenders around the table. When you lend against art, specifically if it's a long-term loan, how do you look at what multiple of income do you expect the borrower to have to be able to service the debt? And what are the sources that you look for?
The clients that we're lending to tend to be entrepreneurial types, hedge fund managers, private equity, that type of person. So they, as a group, tend to be collectors and like every asset to be a working asset. And art is a great asset. It's stable and good for collateral. So we're looking at their reoccurring cash flow and net worth. And we have investment finance teams that analyze their finances. So we don't have a set multiple. It's tailored financing set to the individual. But their cash flow is a key component.
One more.
We also lend against looking to cash flow, but we'll also take a slightly different approach. For example, right now we see a very large market for people who, in fact, are having a more difficult time living on a fixed income because interest rates are so low. So, in fact, they may be retired, they may have relatively modest income and need more income, but don't want to sell the art for a variety of reasons. And so we're happy to lend to those people if we're comfortable with, again, their character, with the credit characteristics of the collateral, and we'll set aside an interest reserve so, in fact, they can access the money, they can monetize the art.
Okay, there's a question at the middle.
What determines the price in this volatility question you raised is the efficiency of the sales process, you know. So is there anything, any organization, any research looking into the rating of galleries, of auctions, of promotion, etc.? Because the price that this vase was sold for depended on the state of mind of the people that were in the room when it happened.
There are no agencies that I'm aware of that rate. We're in a extraordinary, the art market is extraordinary because it's based on taste, emotion, the right person be on the telephone at the right moment. You can have 20 people who all want to buy something, but if there's a British Rail tube strike and they can't get in, the thing doesn't sell and you've had a disappointing result and no agency is keen to rate all that. So it's a very complex, you know, I've been in this market 24 years. It's a very complex market to understand. That's why you need a lot of experts, a lot of knowledge. Sometimes these prices are based, you know, we've seen Peter Doig sell for $2 million and then suddenly two Russian individuals bid it up to $10 million. And I was told this morning that a Peter Doig sold privately for $21 million, and I'm not sure if it's pounds or dollars this week. I sold one for $2 million, which was a new world record price, having bought it for $880,000. But it is down to, on the day, who's going to be in the room, who's interested, and one work of art that looks identical to another. One sells for $9 million, which was a Paul Delvaux in New York, and another one sells for $3 million 3 months later.
The art prices are determined by the people who buy it, and estimating the value of an artwork is an estimate of the entire market for that specific object. And since the market is growing rapidly recently, sometimes it could occur that the estimates are a bit lower than the actual return or the actual sale price. But it's in the end the group of clients and the buyers that decide on the price of an object.
I think we have room for one more question. There's one at the in the middle. Yes. With a microphone.
I have a mic already, thank you. Suzanne, you talk about the volatility of the market and sort of people purchasing Richard Prince, George Kondo, Damien Hirst, and everybody purchasing the same thing. How do you personally insulate your clients? I mean, we also talk about the emotional side to purchasing, and are you pushing them to maybe purchase old masters, contemporary, and impressionist paintings, or how do you determine that, you know, for your clients? Are you pushing them into that, or are you trying to be guided by their taste?
We're not pushing people into buying, and our role isn't to make a diversified portfolio of art from different areas. We think about that with the loan portfolio, but when we're advising clients on buying art, it's personal. We're in their homes, and so we're really working with them, with their aesthetic, and guiding them. And we bought George Kondo just the other day. So it's an artist that we think is a great artist. But when we're buying a George Kondo for a client, we're saying, this is what's going on in the market. These are the risk factors. These are the trends. This is the history of contemporary art. Know what you're getting into. And so it's a lot of education and context. But you know, we're really guiding more than saying, do this one, do that one. But we are outsourcing and identifying.
I think we have to wrap up now. And now I wanted to thank all the participants in this panel for their contribution. And I think I'm sure most of us will hang around during the day. So in the lunch break or in the break, you will have a chance also to ask very specific questions. So again, thank you everyone for your patience and your time. And on to the next one. Thanks.